Good morning, Red Cedar Church. Good morning to those who are joining us online and our friends in Ladysmith. If you do not know me or this is your first time here, my name is Wes, and I want you to know that I love you. More importantly, I want you to know that God loves you. Also, he has a very tender message for you this week. Some of us feel like our dreams have stopped. They've been arrested, if you would, put in prison. But I want you to know that God works in the hardest places, in the darkest of times, with the hardest of situations. He loves you, and your dream is not dead. He is just setting you up for a great exaltation. With that being said, would you pray with me? Father, let us find hope today. Let us submit to your very hard process of growing to be like Christ. God, help us not to take the shortcut, the easy way, but the painful process of becoming like your son. And God, in order for that to happen, they need to trust you. They need to know that you love them and care for them deeply. Because God, this is vulnerable, it's hard, and it's painful. And so God, I pray that hope could emerge and be built today. While although their dream feels like it's in prison, you are transforming their heart in those hard places to get them ready to be the kind of person that can handle the dream once it comes to fruition. Dear Father, pour out grace and mercy on these people that you love more than we'll ever know. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Dare to Dream. The sermon is titled Hope in Prison. We'll be looking at Genesis chapter 40. Here's the main sentence or the main purpose behind the sermon. God gives us hope in dark places. Now, when we think about our dreams being arrested or our dreams being sentenced and judged, put behind bars and the keys thrown away, that's kind of a despair thought. That's hard to think about. But there's been many times in my life where I got to a place in the road where it did not look like my dreams were going to go forward. Where I had tried everything I knew to try, or I'd made so many mistakes, or life just didn't go my way, and Kelly and I were having discussions like, can we proceed with this dream of ministry that God has given us? And in our younger years, that usually revolved around finances. If you're an intern, if you're starting out in ministry, it's extremely low pay, and we weren't the best at taking care of our money in the beginning, and so there were lots of times where we didn't have enough resources, and then I would go buy an awesome fishing pole. And then you put all those together and all the fighting that comes from that, lots of dreams about died in those tense conversations, those hard moments, those learning experiences. But all on the way, God provided a way. Mentors, discipline, growth, training. And in those moments, God would continue to open up doors and continue to move us forward. Even though there were moments where I felt like he had abandoned me, there were moments where I was ashamed for the mistakes that I had made that had led to put me in the circumstances that I was in, and the dream felt arrested. However, God is the God who opens the jail cell, gives grace, and helps us to proceed. We're going to look at how God gives us hope in these dark places. And to do so, we're going to look at Joseph's story. And I just got to say, like, Joseph's story wears me out week to week. Like, it's hard reading it, let alone living it. This poor guy, up and down, up and down. God is preparing him for something big. God had given him a dream, but now he's turning Joseph into the kind of person where he can enjoy that dream. Let's pick up his story, Genesis chapter 40. Sometime later, the cupbearer and the baker of the king of Egypt offended their master, the king of Egypt. Pharaoh was angry with his two officials, the chief cupbearer and the chief baker, and he put them in custody in the house of the captain of the guard, in the same prison where Joseph was confined. The captain of the guard assigned them to Joseph, and he attended to them. After they had been in custody for some time, each of the two men, the cupbearer and the baker of the king of Egypt, who were being held in prison, had a dream the same night, and each dream had a meaning of its own. When Joseph came to them the next morning, he saw that they were dejected. So he asked Pharaoh's officials, who were in custody with him in the master's house, why do you look so sad today? If that was me, like, hey, bro, we're in prison. What do you want me to? We both had dreams, they answered, but there is no one to interpret them. Then Joseph said to them, do not interpretations belong to God? Tell me your dreams. So the chief cupbearer told Joseph his dream. He said to him, in my dream, I saw a vine in front of me, and on the vine were three branches. As soon as it budded, it blossomed, and its clusters ripened into grapes. Pharaoh's cup was in my hand, and I took the grapes, squeezed them into Pharaoh's cup, and put the cup in his hand. This is what it means, Joseph said to him. The three branches are 3 days. Within 3 days, Pharaoh will lift your head and restore you to your position, and you will put Pharaoh's cup in his hand, just as you used to do when you were his cupbearer. But when all goes well with you, remember me and show me kindness. Mention me to Pharaoh and even get me out of this prison. I was forcibly carried off from the land of the Hebrews, and even here I've done nothing to deserve being put in a dungeon. If you're joining us today, Joseph had some dreams. But he had a dream in which his family would bow down to him. He told his older brothers, they threw him in a ditch. They were going to kill him. Out of what they called mercy, they sold him into slavery. And there he was bought by a guard in a high captain in Egypt. And in this, that guy's wife went after him. She accused him of coming on to her, but it was a lie. And now he sits in prison. He's sitting there bankrupt with this vision like, I've done everything I could do to be right. Maybe I've messed up, I've did something, but I don't deserve to be in jail today. When the chief baker saw that Joseph had given him a favorable interpretation, he said to Joseph, I too have a dream. On my head were three baskets of bread. In the top basket were all kinds of baked goods for Pharaoh. But the birds were eating them out of the basket on my head. And this is what it means, Joseph said. And you can tell Joseph tells the truth. The first one's like, hey, your life's going to be great. But now he's about to drop some truth bombs that are not favorable to this guy. This was not a fun delivery. The three baskets are 3 days. Within 3 days, Pharaoh will lift your head and impale your body on a pole, and the birds will eat away your flesh. I'm like, hey, thanks. Thanks for the interpretation. Way to encourage me today. Now the third day was Pharaoh's birthday, and he gave a feast for all his officials. He lifted up the heads of the chief cupbearer and the chief baker in the presence of his officials. He restored the chief cupbearer to his position so that he once again put the cup in the Pharaoh's hand, but he impaled the chief baker just as Joseph has said to them in his interpretation. And maybe the saddest part for Joseph here is he had a glimmer of hope, and God was at work using his gifts. But then the last sentence of this chapter, the chief cupbearer, however, did not remember Joseph. He forgot him. And in his dark moment, in his dark place, where he maybe had a string of hope, he had a rope to climb out of that dark dungeon, yet the people that he helped did not help him. And so, friends, we're going to look at that story today, and we're going to look at our hearts, and we're going to see how God gives us hope and builds and develops hope in us so that we can one day enjoy our dream. Because as God gives you the dream of your heart, he also has to transform you into the kind of person that can handle the reward of that dream. So let's walk through this. The first thing we gather from this text is we must face injustice and trials with integrity. This man was falsely accused and wrongly imprisoned. His brother sold him. His father thinks he's dead. Potiphar's wife falsely accuses him, and now he's sitting in a jail cell. That's hard to deal with. Think about what makes you mad when people say the slightest little thing about you. Now imagine your whole life is wrecked because of other people. He's sitting in a jail cell because of the actions of other people's envy, jealousy, and sin. And here's the hard part about the Bible. The world tells you to scream out and to act a certain way to take vengeance and justice. But God expects his Christian people to keep their character intact and in line with his in even the hardest of situations. Being in a bad spot, getting in a bad beat, being falsely accused is no reason for you to act like the world. God requires the highest character even in the hardest and most darkest situations. You might find yourself in relationships that are hard right now. Maybe you feel like in prison because of your family relationships. Maybe your marriage or the relationships you have with your children are holding you hostage, so to speak. Maybe at work, the relations you have, someone is in a way of you getting a promotion or you getting ahead, and you feel like this person just has it out for you. It could be a situation. Whatever it is, Christian people must face injustice and trials with integrity. And as we introduce each one of these points, I'm going to give you some hope builders. It's easy to say that, but how do we do that? How do we get our hearts in a place where we can be falsely accused, falsely imprisoned, and still not have our heart go the way of the world? Jesus says some crazy things, and this might be the craziest. Commit to loving your enemies. Now, this is different. Now, we've been hearing that for 2,000 years, so it's lost its punch. We just expect that we do that. But that's something that we know we should do but rarely do, right? So I want you to think about that person who gets under your skin right now. You thought about them that quick. It's right there. It's, whoo, yeah, I got it. It's downloaded. Got my top three right here. I don't like them. They hurt me. They make my life hard. Listen to the scripture Jesus says. But I tell you, love your enemies. Love them. And pray for those who persecute you. That doesn't mean they're just like kind of rude. That means they're going after your life. The very things that you hold dear, these are the people that are coming against you. Why does God tell us to love our enemies and pray for the people who are trying to harm us? It's because he's trying to do a fresh work in your heart. Let me tell you about the Holy Spirit for a moment. The Holy Spirit is a genius. He is a counselor, and he has the perfect word that transcends all of our understanding, all of our culture. He knows you perfectly, and he can give you a word in a way that you can understand it, in a way that you can personally hear it. Now, regular counselors or pastors, or we can't do that. There's cultural divides. There's age difference. There's different backgrounds. It's hard to communicate the hearts, but the Holy Spirit can precisely and acutely give you the words you need to transform your heart. And he's a genius in this way. The Holy Spirit has written these words down from Jesus because of this. It is psychologically impossible to pray for someone and hate them at the same time. Try it. When you go home, Lord, here are the three people that I consider my enemy. Again, let's don't lose the spit on that word. Let's don't lose the venom behind the word enemy. I don't like them. They try to harm me. They persecute me. They attack my dreams. Get down on your hands and knees and commit to praying for their blessing. Your heart and your mind will be completely transformed. Now, then you ask the question, why does he do that? Why would he ask me to do it? Is it so we could get a religious star and say, hey, good job, you're different from the world? Yes, maybe, but there's something deeper. Because when you go through that transformational process of praying for your enemies, you're going to quit thinking about what your dream was or just getting ahead, and you're going to start to become like God, and you're going to have pity and compassion on these people for being the kind of people that want to tear other people down. And your heart will transcend all these human transactions, and you will have the heart that is like God's, that you won't be frustrated with people who are sinful in a sinful world, but your heart will rise above it to say things, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. You will have a deeper understanding, and your heart will move towards compassion because the world is so wicked, and people treat each other horribly. We must commit to loving our enemies as a hope builder. But the second thing I'm gonna say is, seems straightforward, but I think we miss its essence sometimes, is we need to build hope in your heart. Yes, that's easy, we think. But I want you to know that hope is not built in one prayer. Hope is not built in a reaction. It's not from a meme. It's not from putting a scripture up on the wall. All those things are helpful. I'm not making fun of any of those things. But the way that God builds hope in our hearts, and if it's going to be character hope, lasting hope, a God gospel-driven kind of hope, it's a process and over time. Listen to how God builds hope in our hearts as we face injustice and trials with integrity. Romans chapter 5, verses 3 through 5. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings. Again, crazy. Bad things happen to me. People are persecuting me. Yes, we glory in these. I don't know about you, when I sit around my friends and want to brag or tell hero stories, I'm going to be like, remember that time where my life was horrible? You know, like, but here's Paul. We glory in these because he's looking for something more, looking for God to do a deeper work. Because we know that suffering produces perseverance. And that leads me to think getting hope in your life is not just a one-time deal. You have to keep saying yes to God. You have to stick in the fight. You have to be willing to do the hard work. You have to partner with God, with his hope, with the Holy Spirit, with gospel power and forgiveness. And once you begin to persevere, perseverance leads to character. And character, my friend, does not happen overnight. And you will not easily love your enemies. You will not easily respond to adversity with hope. It takes time. And character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame. And I want you to hear that this morning from the Holy Spirit, from the scripture, that if you find yourself in a hard, dark spot, he's not going to leave you there to rot or in shame. Why? Because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Let the Holy Spirit deliver his love and build you in hope. But friends, you need to develop that hope with God over time. The second way we see Joseph being a leader, someone who was not giving up, even all odds are against him, and his dream has been completely arrested. He feels forgotten, but he knew something deep here. He needed to serve God in the shadows. You see, Joseph's gift was a dreamer, and he also had the gift of interpreting dreams. And, you know, think about his life right here at this moment. Before, he was the blessed son of Jacob, a patriarch in Israel. His father was in line of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And so he had prominence. And in this prominent family, he was given a prominent place. He was given a special coat. That goes bad. He finds himself in Potiphar's house, and now he's in charge of everything. In a superpower of the world, probably the second or third most powerful person in this administration, Joseph is in charge of all his affairs. He can do whatever he wants, go wherever he wants. He feels special again. Now he's hanging out in prison with a baker and someone who gives wine to the king. He could easily think, like, I don't even want to serve in here. I served in the highest places in the highest of realms, and now I'm hanging out with a couple convicted criminals. Why should I give my time to God, and why should I serve these people? It's not worth it. And I think when despair comes upon us and our life feels dark or our back's up against the wall, we forget that's the training ground in which God pays the most attention to. And we all have a little bit of a manipulator in us. You see, this world loves to do things for people that can help get them ahead. And sometimes we only do things to get ahead. We do it in front of the right people so that we can go ahead. But I want to give you some hope here. And I want to talk about Joseph serving these people because he decides to use his gifts to people who don't matter in this world, and it will be the very thing that gets him promoted at a later date. And you need to know that even if you feel like no one's watching and the people around you have persecuted and it makes no earthly good for you to do the thing, I want you to know that God still cares and God still sees. And if you're going to be a character-driven person who's filled with the Holy Spirit, learn to serve in the shadows and learn to serve the least of these. Here's the hope. When we serve others in the shadows, it builds a purity of heart for us. Matthew 6, 1 through 4, Jesus warning us and trying to build our hearts the right way. Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others, to be seen by them. Don't let the praise of men be your drug. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets to be honored by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you, so to be different, when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father who sees what done in secret will reward you. You see, when you are not trying to manipulate, when you're not trying to put yourself ahead, when you're just serving God, but you're not positioning yourself to make your dream, you're serving from the purity of heart, knowing that you're doing the right things for the right reasons, for the right God, he begins to work in you and you build the right kind of heart. What this is a warning against hypocrisy. Hypocrisy kills hope. Hypocrisy kills the dream. Jesus said it this way, as he commands us to take off this mask of hypocrisy. Talking about these Pharisees, he says, everything, which that's a big word, they do is done for people to see. Friends, all of us need to take off that mask. And all of us have some hypocrite in us. What are the results of hypocrisy? As you serve in the shadows, as you face trials of injustice, if you try to come out of that with the wrong heart, you will face spiritual stagnation. You see, you won't grow if the reason you do things is to be applauded by other people, because that short circuits the Holy Spirit in your heart. He doesn't partner with that. He's not in it for the praise, for us to be seen by men and to do. And you won't spiritually grow because you're not even focusing on God. You're focusing on yourself. It damages the soul because you start to believe your own press clippings. You know in your heart why you do what you do. After a while, some people start believing it all together, but there becomes an inner conflict with the hypocrite. And there's a loss of self-respect because you know deep down why people are saying, wow, man, I can't, you're such an awesome person. You know that you're doing it to be seen by other people. And ultimately, it hurts other believers. And you cannot love God and hate your brothers and sisters. It hurts other believers because if you're focused on yourself and you're doing it to be seen by other people, what you are not doing is offering from a pure heart true spiritual fruit for your brothers and sisters to feast on. They get no spiritual sustenance from being around you. You're not relaying the glory of God and his grace and his love. You're just promoting yourself on your own pedestal. There's nothing to feast on there. Your glory cannot sustain the hearts of your brother or sister. Now, let me give a word of grace here, too. I don't believe that a lot of people become hypocrites for the sake of becoming hypocrites. I think there's another underlying reason with us that we do this. A lot of us have never learned to be vulnerable. And we learn from an early age to wear a mask, to present ourselves to be better so that other people will like us. And we're worried if we take off the mask, the deep question of the heart is, will they really love me? Will they still honor me? If I share my junk, if I tell them where I struggle, if I don't present the best part of myself, will they still honor me and love me? I want you to know this about Red Cedar Church. Our aim, our goal, is for this to be a safe place for you to take off the mask. God knows what we've done. He knows the wickedness of our hearts. He knows all the mess ups, all the bad. He knows everything about you and everything that you carry. And the beautiful part of God is that he still loves you. On your worst day, he gave you his best. And so you need to be able to share your story with at least three or four people. You need some close friends. Now, sharing your story with the whole world might not be beneficial to your soul, and it's probably not wise. But you don't need any secrets as a Christian, and you need to have some people in your life who unconditionally love you, who you can share and bear your soul to, so the enemy cannot use that mask against you. Because as you present a false narrative and the war in the world rewards you, you'll become addicted to that reward and you won't do the real transformational work heart that needs to happen. But if you take off the mask and you receive love from the body of Christ and encouragement, then you will truly begin to grow and be transformed. Stay away from hypocrisy. Some of you need counseling. Because some situations are hard. As I just said, love your enemies. Well, does that mean if someone's abused me, do I have to stay with them? No. And there's lots of wisdom. There's not an A plus B equals C in life all the time. And situations are tough. And you need people. You need wise people in your life to help you make these hard decisions. So if you find yourself confused today, what do I do in this situation? God, I don't know. That's when you ask for help. And I tell you that so you can feel freedom to take off the mask. You're not going to be judged. We're going to love you. And if someone does judge you or be mean to you, we'll deal with it. The third thing we see in Joseph's heart here is he is learning. He is waiting. And he is learning to trust in God's timing. Again, I think the most sad verse in this story is that the chief cupbearer, however, did not remember Joseph. He forgot him. And I just think like, wow, how difficult that might be. I think about my own life and how impatient I am. How I want everything that I want right now. And Amazon has only made that worse for me. I mean, it really, I have an Amazon problem. 7 days. What? I can't wait on that. What in the world? What's going on here? And Kelly's always, like, Kelly's had to teach me a lot of things. I'm so impatient. I used to buy people Christmas presents. I couldn't wait. I'd drive it straight to their house and knock on the door and hand to them back. And Kelly's like, you're embarrassing. Stop being weird. Like, this is weird that you buy people presents and drive it straight to their house. I just couldn't wait. I wanted to experience the smile right away. And then my wife made me stop. And all of us want immediate gratification. We want a microwavable faith. But that food doesn't taste good, does it? When you don't bake it, when you don't give it time to simmer, when you don't use the right ingredients, the meal doesn't taste as good. When you build something, you need choice materials. You need bright architects. You need people who know what they're doing if the building is going to stay the test of time. And we need to learn to wait, even in our exaltation, even in our promotion. And if you try to shortcut it, if you take the wheat step, if you do something to deceive the dinner, you'll only hurt yourself and the people you love. Let me illustrate it this way through the last calling I received from the Lord. At 43 years of age, God called my family to move. And as I've got to know the story of Red Cedar, and I know its people, I know its church history, and I've learned the layout of what this church needs, and then I reflect backwards on my life, I am equipped to handle what this church needs in its next time. And then I was perfectly equipped, and I look back like, oh, that mentor was going to help me with this, and this situation that I struggled in is going to be helpful here, and it really is a fit for me in my life. What I've learned, my mentors, the struggles of ministry that I had is a perfect match for the needs of Red Cedar Church at this time. And then, so that's cool, but I want you to think about it the opposite way. What if I short-circuit that? What if I don't learn those lessons? What if I don't listen to those mentors? Or what if I take a hold of something that's not yet, well, I'm not yet mature enough to do it? What happens? You get hurt by my leadership. And then the spiritual dreams for a period of time by a group of people are not realized because of my immaturity and my inability to wait. And it took 43 years for me to be ready to be a leader here. And I wasn't ready a day early. And he's still growing me. And I still have a lot to learn and grow in leadership. We must learn to trust God's timing. He's going to build it. And friends, if it seems dark, if it seems hard, if it seems impossible, that's what our God specializes in. And I want you to know that his perspective on the dream is greater than yours. Where you feel, if I could just get this, if he would just do it in my time, in my way, you need to know this about the Lord. Isaiah 55, 8, 9 says this, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." We don't know what's going on when we feel pressured and overwhelmed and like nothing's going our way. And what God calls us to do in those moments is to wait, use our gifts the best way we know how, and to make sure that we keep our integrity in every area of our life. And friends, he promises breakthrough. He promises to give you a good foundation on hope, and he's going to build through it. And whatever you're going through right now, he is working in that moment. He's building your heart. He's making you like Jesus. He's going to teach you not the way of revenge, but the way of forgiveness, of love, hope, and peace. What you think is your prison is your training ground for God to do a miraculous work in your heart. He's setting you up. You don't have a setback. He is changing you from the inside out so you don't spoil the dream at a later date. We need integrity. We need to wait. So here's the hope builders for trusting in God's time. You need to learn how to pray. And pray every day. Prayer is hard. Prayer is simple. A child can do it, and an adult never exhausted and is always learning by it. If you're like me, I have a hard time staying focused in prayer. I love reading the Bible. That's my jam. That comes easy. I can get lost in the word. But then I say, okay, I'm going to pray now, Lord. And it's taken me a long time to get to the point of prayer I am now, but my prayers go like, Father, I wonder if Ohio State's going to get that new wide receiver. Kelly really wants another pig. I don't want one. You know, like whatever it is. And I smack myself and I'm like, okay, Lord, I'm paying attention now. All right. I'm entering in. God, help me. Praying for Red Cedar. I'll get through two names. I wonder if it's going to be nice on Friday. You know, my mind's there, and I've had to learn, I just got to walk. I can't just sit still. If I sit still, my mind will go to 100. I would be embarrassed if you saw my Google searches of all the random things that I look up that enter my brain, and I think I need to go read about and wonder. Stuff that I will never do or never be a part of. I just have a curious mind, and I love to read and explore. But I need to focus on prayer. In those prayer moments, I've learned to wait on his presence to give me release, to build hope. It's a practice that you need to learn. You need to hide yourself somewhere where no one sees you. You need to pray to your Father. And the second way you build hope and trust in God's time is you listen to old people. Old people know things. Why they know things? Because they've just been through some stuff. They've raised families and grandkids. They've had trouble at work. They've had days where they didn't feel like their dreams, they felt like their dreams were expiring, but somehow God yet provided. I've held the hands of people dying, saints, and they tell me hard, gut-wrenching life stories, and yet how God's grace helped them all the way through, and that he answered prayers at just the right time. You know, so as a sign of humility, if you want to grow, God is patient. He's got all the time forever. He's not going anywhere fast. The Bible actually describes God as slow, especially according on our timetables. But you see, if you listen to people who've already been through the trial and you humble yourself by listening and you humble yourself by having many wise counselors in your life, you can forego a lot of trouble. You can learn on the pain of someone else what not to do. And it's humbling yourself. But if you don't want to listen to old people, then you can relearn their hard years. And the Bible says you either humble yourselves or you will be humbled. Now I'm speaking from personal experience here. I have humbled myself, and I have been humbled. The first one feels way better. And I always want to put my heart in a place to be humble rather than to be humbled. At this stage of my life, I think God has an angel ready to humble me if I say anything. Like, if I just say it, like, Gabriel will knock me off with the sword as soon as I say it. Like, if I'm prideful by 9, I'm humbled by 12. It just, that's the way it works. But we pray, we listen to counselors. Friends, we must face our trials and our adversity with integrity. We serve God with our gifts in the shadows, not to put ourselves ahead, but just to do it because we believe that God is watching and we trust in his timing. Why? How can we have the strength to endure and to let God create this slow process of hope in our hearts? Because at humanity's darkest hour, 6 hours on a Friday where Jesus was crucified were the darkest hours of human history. And in those moments, Jesus was arrested. He was put in prison. He was tried. He was falsely accused. His own creation nailed him to the cross and mocked him. His own people rejected him and delivered a murderer instead of him. And he went into the prison of death, the final prison, the greatest prison, the darkest prison, which none of us had any power to defeat on our own. But on the third day, God had a dream. A dream that his son would come and die in our place, then rise again. And Jesus was perfect in every way, and he never gave in to the injustice. He always served in the shadows, in the obscurity. He always trusted in God's timing, in God's ways. And because of that, on the third day, he arose again, and he broke out of that prison. And that God who rose from the dead lives in you. And his biggest dream was that you would accomplish your dreams in him. He is the chain breaker. He is the one who released us from the prison of hell, sin and death. And friend, he lives in you. He specializes in unlocking the prison door and letting you out free as a child of God, building and transforming your heart so that you can experience your God-given dreams. The God who got us out of sin and death and the jail of eternity and hell is the God who lives inside of you. He sees you. Let's pray. Father, as we think about people who are struggling today, who feel like their dreams have been arrested, give them the keys to their own jail cell. And although the situation might not come off of them immediately, like we see Joseph, their heart will be free in that situation. And you will transform them. You will give them perseverance, character, and ultimately hope that you have not left them to rot. And although the cupbearer might forget about us, you do not. Your eyes are fixed upon us. Build hope in this room. Build hope to work on hope. Give us a burning desire to have the kind of hearts that want to even attempt praying for our enemies and those who persecute us. Father, help us walk out the ways of Jesus. In your name we pray, amen. You're going to see on the screen here, we prepared a video some time ago. This is just a way to close this sermon out. These are staff talking about long-awaited dreams, hard times, and how God came through. Watch this video with me.
So a dream that I waited for, my wife Chris and I waited for, was when our daughter, our oldest daughter, Brianna, was 16. She really had a lot of questions about her faith, walked away from the faith for a number of years. And we continued on in relationship with her, really praying and asking God to restore her. He not only has restored her, but has redeemed her life. She's leading worship here on weekends, and we are so grateful that God not only answered our prayers and met our dreams, but has redeemed our daughter. It's beautiful.
In my teens and in high school, I had always thought and always dreamed that I would have a wonderful and healthy marriage. But in my 20s, got involved in some really toxic relationships where the girls I was dating would just fight and argue all the time. And I thought that was gonna be my future, where I'd always be in these toxic relationships that were just absolutely draining. But God had something else in mind. If I ended those relationships and lived into the life that God calls us to, and God, thankfully, so much brought me Rachel, who is an absolute joy, brings so much energy and life into my life. I'm very blessed to be married to Rachel for over 13 years.
It was probably about 5 years ago. My husband and I were trying to find the right piece of property to call home, a hobby firm that my husband could, you know, enjoy and raise animals, a place we could raise our kids. We found the perfect piece of property, and due to external factors that really were outside of our control, we put in an offer. We tried to put in an offer, but everything fell through. The house was pulled off the market, and we spent a year and a half praying, and we were disappointed, trying to figure out like what's next. But we knew when we stepped foot on that property that that was home. A year and a half later, the house came back on the market. We got the house for a much better price than what we would have paid before. And what was even better is that the timing, God's timing, worked everything out in a way that we couldn't have been happier with. We ended up getting our house right before COVID hit. And what a blessing it was to have that piece of property out in the country when we had to quarantine, we had to raise our kids. And it was a beautiful expression of God's love and what happens when we wait on God's timing.